So you would ask that. The question is, the question is, speech brings order out of chaos. That's what I said, but it appears that speech brings chaos out of order as well. And the answer to that is, it does. There was only so many complications I could address in the talk simultaneously. If you look at the most archaic of archetypal heroes, those heroes confront something that represents chaos. It's usually a monster that bears a treasure of some sort. And that's a symbolic representation of the class of all unexplored things, right? Because things that we have not yet explored are threatening and destructive, but also offer us infinite potential. But more elaborated hero stories, let's say, also reverse that and say that, well, there are times when the order has become so corrupt and rigid that free speech fragments it into its parts so that it can rejuvenate itself. And so, I mean, actually in the Gospels, that's the hero that Christ is basically represented as. He's not so much the dragon confronting the dragon slayer who gathers the treasure, although that's implicit in the juxtaposition of Christ with the figure of like a serpentile Satan. But Christ is the thing that stands up against the corrupt state and rejuvenates it through speech. And so, technically speaking, free speech, the logos, is the thing that mediates between chaos and order. And you can think about, this is represented in many cultures, this idea. You can see it most specifically, I would say, in the Taoist conceptualization, because in the Taoist world, being is made out of chaos and order. Yin and yang, masculine and feminine. Fundamentally, it's chaos and order. And order is the fact that wherever you go, there are things you understand. And chaos is the fact that wherever you go, there are things you don't understand. And so the idea is that being is made out of the things that you understand and the things that you don't understand. And it's always that way, which is why Tao is the symbol of being per se. And it's the case. Your brain is adapted, in fact. It's partly why it has two hemispheres. For the world that you understand and the world you don't understand. The world you understand, roughly speaking, being handled by the left, and the world you don't understand, roughly speaking, being handled by the right. Well, it's that line down the middle that's Tao. That's meaning. And if you have one foot in chaos and one foot in order, you're maximizing information flow and rejuvenating yourself at the same time that you're maintaining your structure. And you will report on that internally as engagement in the world. It's the most fundamental orienting sense that you have. And it's deeply instantiated neurologically, unbelievably deeply. And so it really is the case, from an evolutionary perspective, that reality is chaos and order. It's that to which you're adapted. And so sometimes you're speaking on behalf of chaos, and sometimes you're speaking on behalf of order. It's more complicated than that too, though, because when we have a dialogue, say, and we're mutually attempting to climb towards the truth instead of convincing each other that we're right, say, then what we're doing is engaging in the simultaneous fragmentation of old and archaic belief systems and their updating. And you can experience that because someone will say something that sets you back, and then you'll get what they're saying and it'll click together. And what you're experiencing is the death of an old conceptualization structure, its disintegration, and then its reconfiguration in a tighter order. And people love that. They live for that. It's really what keeps you alive. And you can experience that in a deep conversation, a truthful conversation, a meeting of the minds and soul. And people love that. It's curative. All psychotherapists know this. Because what you do in psychotherapy, as well, in addition to helping people face the things that they're most afraid of so that they can overcome them, is to allow them to tell someone the truth. What happened to you? I'll listen. So they tell you, and they take themselves apart and put themselves together while they're speaking the truth about what happened. And it puts them together. It's at the two fundamental elements of psychotherapy are: let's find what you're afraid of and avoiding and help you confront it so that you can gather the information that's there. And let's allow you to lay your story out in all of its catastrophe and detail so that you can straighten yourself out through speech. That's exactly what happens in psychotherapy. So, and it should happen in every real relationship. It's the spiritual purpose of a marriage, fundamentally, right? Because you face someone who's different than you that you're tied to and cannot run from. And so you can reveal yourself. Really, it's a critical part of marriage. Because if you can run from someone, they will never show you their true face. Because if someone shows you their true face, you will run. And so you say in a marriage ceremony, I will allow you to show me your true face and I will not run. And unless you mean that, you'll never be married. You'll never understand what it means. And you'll never reap the benefits of it, which are practical, obviously, but also spiritual and psychological. There's a reason for the vow, but it has to be a vow. Because otherwise you have a back door open and you'll never really tell the person what you're like. And no bloody wonder, because really, who wants to know what you're like? Not even you, that's for sure.